The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 13, given by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in March 1966 at the Mishra Yoga Society, New York.
Behinasmin jatha behi, kumana jovanam jara, tatha dehantanam prapti, Dhira Sattva Namayati. This is 13th slok. You can open it. The Sanskrit word is Dena Asmin Jatha Dehe Komaram Jovanam Jara Tatha Dehantanam Prati Dhira Sattva Namayati. Certain, yes.
Just as boyhood youth in old age are attributed to the soul through this body, he is a soul that attains another body. The wise man does not get deluded about this.
Yes. Now, this wise man, the word, Sanskrit word, is dhira. Dhira means that one who is undisturbed in mind. And our disturbance of the mind is due to our ignorance. Suppose I want to go somewhere. Now I am in the station, and actually it so happened when I came to New York first from India, I was to be dispatched to Butler by the bus station. But I was a new man. I did not know the rules and regulations. Of course, somebody was guiding me. Still, I was very much in disturbed condition, how to get on the bus, how to get the ticket, how all it. So, disturbance of mind is due to our ignorance. Yes, come in. So, disturbance of mind is due to our ignorance. So here, a very nice word, you can come in. Alright. Here, a very nice word is used, dhira. Dhira. Dhira means undisturbed. Undisturbed. So, this we should carefully know that our mind in the material condition is always disturbed. Always disturbed. And this is due to our unfavorable condition. Because we are actually spirit in identity. And we have been put into material condition. We can very well experience and we have I got experience, and here is a Captain Pandya, he has also experience. He may be more than experienced than me. When we pass through the sea on the ship, although we are on the ship quite safe, still when there is some storm, when there is some disturbance on the ocean, we also become very much disturbed. Because that situation is foreign to us. You see? We are not so much disturbed in the land as we are disturbed in the ocean. Because we know that our position in the ocean is not our natural condition. So we should not. That disturbance is due to our unnatural condition. Otherwise there is no question of disturbance. So, whole disturbance of mind, it is described in the Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Tassadu Manne Siravajya Dihinam Sada Samadvigna Dhyam Asad Graha. Ityatmaghatam Grihanda Kupam Banangatojat Harimasrayeta. This is a verse in connection with talks between Maharaj Prahlad and his father, Hiranyakashipu. His father was gross materialist, Hiranyakashipu. Hiranya means gold, and Kashipu means a soft bed. So materialists, they are concerned with gold and soft bed for enjoyment, you see. So his name was Hiranyakashipu. And the Prahlad, his son, Prahlad means prakishtarupena Allahad. Allahad means pleasure. He is always full of pleasure. He has nothing to do with material, because material pleasure cannot give us pleasure. It is our mistake. But because we have no information of the spiritual pleasure, and because we are conditioned by this material body, therefore we seek pleasure through matter. Now, we have to raise ourselves from this position, and then we can get unlimited pleasure. We want pleasure, but we do not want such pleasure which ends. We want a non-ending pleasure. That is our heart's desire. But in material pleasure, we cannot have that thing. Even if you take a very good foodstuff, just delicious, still, after taking some portion of it, you will feel yourself satiated. Then that very foodstuff, you will say, no, I don't want any. Because that ends. So that is not real pleasure. Real pleasure is defined ananta. Ananta means that which has no end. So that pleasure you can have only when you are spiritually realized soul. That is possible. We are reading all these scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, and there are so many Vedic literatures that if anyone wants to have spiritual life, there is complete facility. Now, this Prahlad was a boy, a child, not boy, he was only 5 years old. So his father called him, my dear son, what you have learned from your teacher, best, please explain. So he is explaining this. Tatsadhumanne suravajya dihinam sadasamudvignam dhyam asadgraha hityatmaghatam grihandakubam banangato jat harimasayata. My dear father, and his father was materialist, therefore materialists are called in Sanskrit language asura. There are two kinds of human being all the time, asura and deva. Deva means human beings who are connected with the Supreme Lord. Their life is for realization of the Supreme Truth. They are called deva. Just like in higher planets, there are also living beings. They are called devatas, demigods. Because their magnitude of pleasure is far, far greater than ours. But because they do everything in relation with the Supreme Lord, therefore they are called devata. Devata. Devata means demigods. And asura, asura means just the opposite. They simply enjoy life for the matter of sense pleasure, that's all. So those who are interested in sense pleasure, they are called asuras. And those who are interested unending spiritual pleasure, they are called devatas. Devata and asura does not mean that asuras are very ugly and devatas are very beautiful. Even the ugly man can become a devata. Or even a beautiful man may become an asura. That is due to his mentality. Because after all, the soul is pure. When he is in unnatural condition of life, wants to enjoy simply the material senses, he becomes asura. So asura can be turned into devata. There is no hindrance. So Prahlad Maharaj, just see, the father was asura and the son was devata. So ye asura's son can be devata. And a devata's son can be and asura. Just like in India, nowadays there is a great movement for removing the caste system. Because the higher caste, Brahmins, they are claiming due to their birthright higher position. And the other, they are in inconvenience. Nowadays the Brahmins are doing the same thing what we are doing, a Sudra, why he should claim. So there is that quote. You see? So devata asura, the division is that, of course, according to our Shastra, the Brahmin family means devata family. But because nowadays their descendants, they are deviated from the Brahminical culture, they are not to be considered as devatas. That is also mentioned in the Shastra. They are called Brahma Bandhus. According to Shastra, they are called Brahma Bandhus. Brahma Bandhus means son of a Brahmin, but not a Brahmin. Just like a son of High Court Justice, he can claim that I am the son of a High Court Justice, that's all. But because he is the son of a High Court Justice, he cannot claim that I am also the Justice of the High Court. So that consideration is there. So asura devata, there is no such formula that in this line only the asuras will come and in this line only the devatas will come. The asura can be converted into devata and the devatas also can be converted into asuras according to their action. Chaturvarnam maya system gunaganna vibhagasah. In the Bhagavad Gita you find that this four division of caste that is created by me, maya system, I have created. But how it is? According to guna and karma, according to quality and according to his work. He never says according to birth. So just see. Now, here, Hiranyakasipu. Hiranyakasipu is asura, but his son is devata, Prahlada. Now, according to birthright, he should be also asura. But no, he is devata, Prahlada Maharaj. Prahlada Maharaj is counted one of the great 12 great personalities who can distribute transcendental knowledge. They are called Mahajan. Mahajan. Now this Prahlada Maharaj, because he is Mahajan, his statement should be accepted. So he is saying to his father, Asura Vajja, my dear father, you are the greatest of the Asuras. Asura Varya. Varya means greatest. So addresses his father, Asura Bhaji, Asura, because your aim is simply sense pleasure. You see? So, tasadu manne asura vajja dehina. The father asked the son, what you have learned the best thing. So he is also saying, sincerely, before his father, the best thing. So, my dear father, for the dehina, here also the same thing, dehina. Dehina means yatha dehi. Dehina. Dehina means the spiritual spark who has accepted this material body. This material body is foreign. That will be explained. Just like your coat and shirt is foreign to your self. Similarly, this material body is foreign. So dehinam, dehina means one who has accepted this material body. So, we have accepted, but accepted means we have done something by which we have been forced to accept. Forced to accept. Just like if you are put into the prison house has got separate dress. So when you are put into the prison house, you have to keep aside your own household dress, and you have to take that particular dress. If you say, no, no, I cannot accept this dress, I am a gentleman, I have got costly dress, I shall put on that. No, you must. Forced. Similarly, we living entities, we are forced to accept different kinds of dress. There are 8,400,000 kinds of dresses like this body. And your body, my boy, you see, now we are here, several ladies and gentlemen, but you will find that nobody's body will be similar to the other's body. And God's arrangement is so nice that everyone has got his particular body according to his work. It is so nice arrangement, you see. You will find millions of persons, and everyone will find different from the other. You won't find two similar persons. So dehina, because there are different kinds of mentality. Not that all our mentality is one and the same. No, no. And the law of nature is so final that according to the different kinds of mentality, they have got different kinds of body. So dehina means. So Prahlad Maharaj says that tasadumanni suravajya dehina. Dehina means of those who have accepted this material body, for them. And what is their condition? That dehina sada samadvigna dhyam. Dehina, one who has accepted this material body, his conditional life is always full of anxiety. Not that you are always in want, even in your duty. Just like our captains are here, I have seen in this sea, he has got very serious duty. See, in the ocean, he is always consulting the chart and the latitude, longitude, which side the ship is going, and that is anxiety. Because so many lives, so many property is under his control. Any slight mistake would play havoc. We do not know. I was asking this captain, sir, where we are going? But I do not know. I see simply Bhaskar water. But he has not responsible. He knows the thing. So any responsible officer, any responsible, your President Johnson, he is also full of anxiety. I am also full of anxiety. You are also full of anxiety. Even a small bird, you will find. You give a small bird some grain, you will see like this. Is there any? Somebody is coming. Somebody is killing me. So full of anxiety. This is the condition. So you cannot be free from the anxiety. Dehina, Prahlad Maharaj says, sada samadvigna dhyam, and why this anxiety? Na asad graha. Because he has accepted this temporary body. He is eternal. A living spirit is eternal, but he has been forced to accept this temporary body. This is my position. One should be conscious of his precarious position, that I am eternal, but I am encased in a temporary body, which will not exist. However, I may try to make it youthful by so many arrangements. But no, the science cannot give you permanent life. Oh, that is not possible. You may, however, may be proud of your scientific advancement of knowledge, but Bhagavad Gita says that four things: janma mittu jara vyadhi dukkha dosana darsanam. My dear sir, however you may make advancement in scientific knowledge, you cannot stop birth, you cannot stop death, you cannot stop old age, neither you can stop disease. So long you have got this body, so we must have anxiety. That is the law of nature. Now here it is said that, let us finish that. Prahlama said, sada samidmagna dhiyam. My dear father, for persons who have accepted this temporary material body and is full of anxiety always, for them, my idea is that they should give up this materialistic life and surrender unto Hari. Hari means Bhagavan, the Supreme Lord. That is the way of getting out of, and actually this is so. And in the Bhagavad Gita, you will find and the last instruction to Arjuna is sarva-dharmān parityajya māmekam saraṇam. This is the most confidential knowledge I am giving you, because you are my friend and because I love you very much. Therefore, this is my last word. So we can get free from all anxieties as soon as we are surrendered to Hari. That is the whole system of spiritual knowledge. Ārādhita yadi haris tapasā tatat kim. If you accept from the very beginning this principle that I must surrender unto the Supreme Lord, then there is no other necessity of prosecuting your spiritual knowledge. That is the final spiritual knowledge. Ārādhita yadi haris tapasā tatat kim. Tapasā means penances, accepting penances for spiritual realization. Now, one who has accepted the worship of the Supreme Lord, he has no more anything to do for spiritual realization. He has realized. And Nārādhita yadi haris tapasā tatat kim. And after undergoing so much severe penances, if one does not understand what is God, then whole thing is spoiled. Tapasā tatat kim, whole penances is spoiled, because he could not reach the ultimate goal. Ārādhita yadi haris tapasā tatat kim, nārādhita yadi haris tapasā tatat kim. Antar bahi yadi haris tapasā tatat kim. One who has achieved that knowledge, that he can see within himself and outside always the Supreme Lord, he has no more necessity of any penance. And after undergoing all sorts of penances, if I cannot realize that God is within me and God is without everywhere, then all my penances are spoiled. These are very nice. So here it is saying that dhīra, dehinasmin yathā dehi kaumārajo manang jarā, tathā dehāntram prāpti dhīra satra namiyati. Dehina means one who has accepted this material body. Asmin, man in this world, or in this life, jatha, as dehe. Dehe means within the body. Yeah, because dehina means one who has accepted this body, and dehe within this body. So I am sitting within this body. No, I am not this body. Just like you are within this hat and coat. Similarly, I am also within this body, this gross body and the subtle body. This gross body is made of this earth, water, and fire, air, and ether. This gross, this whole material body. Now, in this earth, in this planet, earth is prominent. Anywhere, the body, material body is made of these five elements. Earth, water, fire, air, and ether. These are the five ingredients. Just like this building, this whole building is made of earth, water, and fire. You have taken some earth and you have made bricks and burnt into the fire, and after mixing the earth with water, you make a shape of brick and then you put into the fire. And then when it is strong enough, then you set it. That's like a big building. So it is nothing but a display of earth, water, and fire. Simply. That's all. Similarly, our body is also made in that way. Earth, water, fire, air, and ether. Air is passing, we're breathing, you know, that air is always there. This outer skin is hard, and there is heat in the stomach. Without heat, you cannot digest anything, you see. As soon as the heat is diminished, your digesting power becomes bad. There are so many things. This is ailment. Now, in this planet, we have got this body, which is where earth is very prominent. Similarly, in other planets, somewhere water is very prominent, somewhere fire is very prominent. In the sun planet, the body is there. There are also living entities. But their body is so made that it is fiery. They can exist in the fire. They can exist in the fire. Similarly, in the Varuna Loka, in the Venus, all these planets, they have got different types of body. Just like here you can experience that in the water, the aquatics, they have got a different type of body. For years and years together, there are aquatic animals, they are within the water, they are very comfortable. But the moment you drag it to the land, it dies. Similarly, you are very comfortable on the land, but the moment you are put into the water, you die. Because your bodily construction is different. His body is the bodily construction different. The bird's bodily, the bird, heavy bird, it can fly. But God's made flying instrument. But your man-made instrument, it crashes, you see, because that is artificial. So this is the arrangement. Every living being has got a particular type of God. Dehinas means yathade. And what is the nature of that body? But here, the matter is being explained that how we change our body. How? Because that is a difficult problem for us. Because we are engrossed with the idea of identifying this body with the soul. Now, the first ABCD of spiritual knowledge is to understand that I am not this body. Unless one is firmly convinced that I am not this body, he cannot make progress in the spiritual life. So the first lesson in the Bhagavad Gita is taken in that way. So here, the dehi not me. Now dehi is soul. Soul, dehi means soul. One who has accepted this body, material body, he is called dehi. So assuming he is there, but his body is changing. His body is changing. Now our body was formed in the womb of my mother. That is also described in the Srimad Bhagavat, the physiology of this body. It is said that according to our karma, we are put through the semina of the father, injected into the womb of the mother. And the father's secretion and the mother's secretion, that is emulsified, and takes the form of a pea, and that pea gradually develops. In 3 months, there are holes, 9 holes, the eyes, ears, nose, and the... just like we have got 9 holes. And in 7 months, the whole body is complete. Then the child gets consciousness. And 10 months, it is just ready to come out. So by year, the same year, forces the child to come out. And the mother's connection, because so long a child remains within the womb of the mother, she takes through the mother. So there is an intestinal connection between the child and the mother. So after the child comes out, the intestinal connection is cut off and he becomes a separate identity. That is the law. Now, our point is, as from the mother's womb, from the very beginning of her birth, as the body develops. Similarly, after coming out of the body, it also develops. But the spirit spark is there the same. The body takes development. So, now, that development from this small child, he becomes a bigger child, then becomes a boy, then becomes a youth, then gradually an old man like me, and then gradually when this body is no longer useful, then it has to be given up and another body has to be taken. This is the process of transmigration of soul. I think there is no difficulty to understand this simple process. Now the soul is there. The body is transforming every moment. Every moment. Imperceptibly. Just like if you have seen some your friend's child is small, and after 5 years you go to that friend's house and see the child. Oh, you have grown so big. You have grown so big. But the father, mother cannot see. Because they are seeing daily, they do not see how my child is doing. Daily. But a man who comes all of a sudden after 5 years, he says, oh, the child is grown up. So imperceptibly, we are changing our body every moment. Every moment. And that is also medical science, that we are changing our blood corpuscles every moment, you see. Similarly, what is the difficulty to understand that the soul transmigrates from one body to another? It is very nicely explained here. As the owner of the body is there within the body, but the body is changing one after another. Dehinasmin jathadehi, kumara juvana. Here two examples are given. Kumaram, kumaram means the age up to 15 years. The age after 15 years, that is called kumaram. And from 16 years, so upwards, so after 40 years, one is youth. And then after 40 years, one becomes old. This is the process of this body. But it will be later on explained. The spirit soul within this body, that is not changing. The body is changing. Dehinasmin jathadehi komarajuvanam jaraha tatha dehantram prati dhirasvata dhira means the man who is out of ignorance. Dhīra-svatana. Dhīra means, we began first that one, dhīra means one who is out of ignorance. That means. So one who knows the process of the body changing every moment, then why he should lament when this body is left and another body is there? Suppose if I throw away this covering of my body and take another covering, then what is their lamentation? What is the cause of lamentation? One should be rather glad that the old garment is thrown away and one new garment is taken up. So this question, because Arjuna was disturbed that how can I fight with my grandfather? That is all right. That is my duty to fight. But how can I fight with my grandfather Bhishma Dev, with my teacher Dronacharya? It is not possible. So he is playing the part of a fool, but he was not a fool, but just to teach us. Unless he becomes a fool like us, why this Bhagavad Gita will come? The Bhagavad Gita, just like it is a play, Krishna is constant companion of Arjuna. So Arjuna cannot be put into that ignorance. It is for our benefit that by the will of the Lord Krishna, Arjuna is put into that sort of ignorance. So he is asking Krishna all these questions, just like a foolish man, and Krishna is giving instruction. So that it is being recorded in the history of Mahabharata for future generations. So here, Arjuna, he was declining fight, that how can I fight with my grandfather? You see, he is respectable. He has brought me up since my father's death, and he is my teacher, Dronacharya. He has taught me this military art. Whatever I am warrior, my expertness is due to him. And do you think, Krishna, I shall kill them? No, I can fight with them, I can kill them, but it is not my duty. So Arjuna says like that, but Krishna says, no, you must be dutiful. Never mind who is that, your grandfather or your teacher. No. When there is fight, you are a kshatriya. A kshatriya should not be, has no other consideration in the fight. He must fight. So here is the thing, see, that Krishna does not say that you become a non-violent. No, never says that. When there is question of fighting for right cause, you must fight. There is no question of becoming non-violent, you see. Now he is saying that don't be aggrieved and even your grandfather, Bhishma Dev, died, even your Dronacharya, it will be good for them, because they are now old enough. And as soon as they are dead, they get a new body. So you should not be discouraged. Then one thing is that we mean to say that therefore a man should be killed. No. We cannot kill without reason. No, that will be a great sin. But this is a fight. This is a fight for a cause. They are not killers. It is said that a kshatriya who lays down his life in the battlefield, he at once rises up to the higher planets. Because for right cause, if one lays down his life, just like so many people, they lay down their life for the cause of the country. Do you mean to say they are sinful or they are going to hell? No. Those who are laying down for the good cause, their life, their next life is very brilliant. But if you commit suicide without any reason and written or without any cause, then you will be sinful. These are, of course, we get knowledge from this. So, dehinasmin jathadehi kaumanajubanam jada tatha dehantram prapti dhira-sattva. So dhira, one who has got complete knowledge of the constitution of this body and the constitution of the spirit soul, they are not aggrieved when a soul transmigrates from one body to another. That is the sum and substance of the whole this verse. Now, here some philosophical question may be raised. There are two classes of philosophers that after liberation, after getting out of the body, the soul amalgamates with the Supreme Soul. That question we have already discussed. Still, there is no harm discussing it again, because any substance and knowledge, if it is discussed one after another, twice, thrice, it is better. Now, Krishna points out that every soul is individual soul. Every soul, and that is our experience, that every one of us, we have got some individual consciousness. Not that my consciousness is just equal to your consciousness. I do not know what is going to be. So we are all individual souls. But according to Mahavadi, the philosopher, they say, just like the sky, the ether is everywhere, within your body and within mine and within everyone. That the ether has taken a form due to this particular body, but when the body is vanquished, the ether amalgamates with the greater ether. This is called ghatakas patakas. Ghatakas patakas means if akas is here. Now, akas means ether. Ether is here. Now, that ether, now by this body. Now, this body, there is also ether. Now, as soon as this body is destroyed, it is burned, or it is in another way destroyed, that this ether within my body becomes amalgamated with the greater ether. So, this then sort of assertion is not accepted in the Bhagavad Gita. Because the first reason is that ether is a material thing. Ether is a material thing. And the soul is spirit. We'll have in the later sloka that soul cannot be cut. Soul cannot be cut into pieces. The spirit cannot be achidriyam madajayam. We'll get those slogans. Soul is never can be cut into pieces. You see, just like here is a paper, I can tore this paper into pieces, but it is not possible for the soul. Then it loses its eternity or its stability. You see. So we cannot compare ether with soul, because they are two different subject matter. You see, analogy. Now those who are present here, those who have knowledge of logic, analogy. Analogy is possible when the two things are when there are greatest number of similarities of two things. Then there can be analogy. Otherwise, there is no question of analogy. Just like if I say, oh, this lady's face is just like the moon. Now, there must be some similarity in this face and the moon. As the moon is bright and very beautiful look at, therefore this face must be very beautiful and very bright. And if the face is ugly, how can I compare with this moon? So, whenever we make some analogy, there must be points, greater number of points of similarity. Now here, ether is a material thing and soul is spiritual thing, so there is no similarity at all. At all. And besides that, so a soul, the individual soul, is different from the very beginning. Nitya, Nitya Sāsvatuyam. In later verses we will come to understand. The Lord says that these individual souls, they are my parts and parcels. Mamīvāṁsa jīva-bhūta. Jīva-bhūta, these living entities, they are my parts and parcels. How it is that? And I can give you a very good example. Just like the sun. Sun and the sun ray. What is the sun ray? The sun ray, if you analyze physically, you will find small molecules of raising atoms, shining atoms. This is material, you see. The sun ray is nothing but combination of shining atoms. It is not an homogeneous thing. Anything you take, you are artist, take a point, any color, any photograph, if you analyze it with a microscope or magnifying glass, you'll find so many spots, is it not? You are also artist. So, in God's nature, there is nothing homogeneous. There is nothing homogeneous. All molecules, atoms, particles, even in the matter. So similarly, we living entities, we are also spiritual atoms. We are spiritual atoms. And our magnitude also has been assayed in this shastra. That magnitude is stated in the Purana, that kesagra satabhagas satadha kalpitasya cha. Kesagra, your hair, I have no long hair you have got. Now you can see the point of the hair. Kesagra, agra means the point of the hair. Kesagra satabhagas. Now the point of the hair you divide into 100. That is imaginable. That's not imaginable by you, how the point of the hair can be divided into 100. Kesagra satabhagasya. Now take one part of that division and again divide into 100. This is beyond your experience, beyond your power. By arithmetic calculation, mathematicians say that the point has no length and breadth. Oh, this is a disappointment, because he cannot measure the length and breadth of the point, therefore he says like that. But point has length and breadth. Anuraniyana mahato mahiyana. Therefore, a certain class of philosophers, they are astonished simply by seeing the great magnitude of the Lord. But there is smallest, anuraniyana. This is much smaller than the atom. Magnitude. So that is beyond our experience. Therefore we say nirākār. Nirākār means we cannot calculate the ākār, the actual form. Nirākār does not mean that it has no form. It has form. That they say that the point has no length and breadth. Similarly, the soul has everything length and within that point. It has got his head, legs, everything, consciousness, everything there. And because it is beyond the calculation of our human knowledge, therefore they are disappointed. Nirākār. It has akār. Our senses are so blunt that we cannot calculate. In these days of scientific advancement, you take a dead man, you sit down. Now we shall see how the soul transmigrates from this body. You cannot see. Our eyes are not qualified to see it. Therefore, the only senses, they should be spiritualized. If we want to see the spirit whole, the Lord is spirit whole, we cannot see in the spirit part. We are very much proud of our senses. But our senses are so imperfect that now I see with my eyes, but I cannot see my eyelids, you see. The eyelid is always attached with my eye, but it I cannot see. So our power of using the senses, that is very limited. So we should not depend only on the senses. As a pratyaksha, it is called pratyaksha anumana. There are three kinds of evidences: pratyaksha, anumana, and aitijya. Pratyaksha means that you can directly perceive. That is called pratyaksha. And anumana means you can conjecture. It may be like this. It may be like this. Perhaps it is like this. This is called anumana. And the other evidence is aitijya. Aitijya means to take evidences from the authority. So, out of these three evidences, this aitijya evidence, just like we are taking instruction of Bhagavad Gita, sound vibrated by the greatest personality, Sri Krishna, that sort of praman is accepted. That is the best. This is the best way of acquiring knowledge. Because so far direct evidence is concerned, it is impossible because our senses are so imperfect, we cannot have anything. We can have some direct experience of certain things, but not for all, especially for this spiritual things, which is beyond our experience. So pratyaksha means direct evidence you cannot have. And anumana means speculation. Simply, it may be like this, it may be like that. That is also imperfect. Because our thinking power is also limited. Because our senses are limited. So our thinking power is, mind is one of the senses. Out of the ten, the mind is considered to be the 11th sense. There are five: karmendriya and sensory organs and working organs. 10, and the mind is the chief. So mind is also considered as one of the senses, the chief senses. Because it is sense, it is imperfect. So by mental speculation, we cannot have it into right conclusion. By mental speculation. Though are simply speculating on mind, they can make some progress to a certain extent, but they cannot reach the ultimate goal. It is not possible by mental speculation. Neither it is possible by direct evidence. The only possible evidence is the authority. Just like yesterday also I gave you that example. Just like if a child asks his mother, "So who is my father?" Now the mother says, "Here is your father." But if the child says, "I don't believe it," so he has no other source of knowledge. Except the mother's version, that here is your father, he has no other alternative to know who is father. It is such a thing that neither he can imagine, speculate, or he may be my father, he may be my father, he may be my father. A lots of father he can gather. That is not possible. And neither it is possible for direct perception. The only possibility is the mother's evidence. Similarly, as the mother is the authority for the child, similarly, the Shruti, the Veda, they are called mother of knowledge. So, for such spiritual knowledge, we have to accept the authority. Now here, the Bhagavad Gita is authority. It is accepted. Don't think that it is a scripture of the Hindus. No, it is for all human beings. There is reason, there is science, there is philosophy. It is not dogmatic. So it is to be understood simply. So, and not only that, actually it is accepted by all countries. not only in your country, but in other countries also, Bhagavad Gita is accepted as one of the greatest book of authority. So, this is the process. You should know it, that the spirit soul, as it is stated in the Bhagavad Gita, Dehinas means Yathade, Komana Jovana Jara, Tathade Hantram Prati, Dhiras Satyanam. As the soul is within the body, and the body is changing every moment, similarly, the last stage of change is called death.